Hello and welcome to the National D-Day Memorials Lunchbox Lecture. I am John Long, the Director of Education here at the Memorial, and it's great to have you joining us virtually. It's a beautiful day in Bedford, Virginia, so certainly invite you to come by and join us in person. Great day to take a tour, great time of the year to enjoy the beauty of our memorial. And I'm joined by my colleague, Sarah, across the way, handling all the computer. Our intern, Madeline Rice, is also over there monitoring things for us. So a whole team here to make the technology work. And before we get started with our program today, I want to give a few reminders of what is coming up. One, right around the corner is our annual Armed Forces Day 5K race, which is this Saturday. But before you come up to the memorial with your running shoes on, it is a virtual race, once again, where that you can run anywhere in the country you happen to be. Registration is, the t-shirt deadline has closed, but registration is still open. If you go to our webpage, dday.org, under the events tab, you can still register to run the 5K and support the National D-Day Memorial, as well as show your support for our armed forces in this great race that we've done for many years now. Then, of course, our next Lunchbox Lecture is coming up in 2 weeks, May 20th, and it will be a special look back at the National D-Day Memorial on its 20th anniversary, or approaching its 20th anniversary. We are 20 years old this year. And to mark and give you kind of a backstage look and here's some interesting recollections, we will be walking around the site with our president, April Cheek Messier, who has been here for 20 years. She was started right at the beginning, to hear some of the little known accounts, stories of how this sculpture came to be there or that building happened to be constructed, as well as some of her favorite recollections. And look back at how we got from there to here over the last 20 years. So that will be a great event you don't want to miss. Join us on the 20th at noon for Stories of the National D-Day Memorial at 20. Then, of course, Memorial Day is right around the corner as well. May 31st, I believe, is the day, Monday. In lieu of a big in-person ceremony, as we have traditionally done, but which they don't make a lot of sense in the days of COVID, we will be having smaller events here at the memorial, as well as launching a video, which will, among other things, announce the addition of two names to our necrology wall, where we record the names of every Allied soldier, sailor, airman, Coast Guardsman who died on D-Day. We are continually researching that subject and periodically have the occasion to add names to our wall. And this year, we will be doing just that. So again, a very special Memorial Day coming up. You can join us on site, certainly. But if you are in Nebraska, please join us virtually to mark Memorial Day and especially to pay tribute to two names that have been overlooked for 77 years now. Then June 6th is, of course, the anniversary of D-Day. That is a Sunday, so we're actually going to have a whole weekend of events in lieu of our usual big commemoration. On June 4th, Friday, we will have a very interesting conversation with three well-known D-Day historians, John McManus, Joe Balkowski, and Mitch Yockelson. Three very well-known and widely regarded experts on the Second World War and best-selling authors. We will have the opportunity to talk to them, pick their brains about their understanding of D-Day. And again, something you don't want to miss. It'll be absolutely fascinating. On June 5th, Saturday, we will have a whole series of events, family-friendly events, to help raise awareness of what happened on June 6, 1944. We will have reenactors. We will have, of course, our usual guided tours, children's activities, activities geared around the World War II phenomenon of the Victory Garden. a lot going on June 5th. So join us for that. And then, of course, on the actual anniversary, June 6th, we will commemorate D-Day. Again, not with a large in-person event, but with a video launch, as well as some smaller events here on site, including Ash Rothline, a Normandy veteran, who will be with us to pay tribute to his generation and particularly to the Bedford Boys. So please join us for all of that coming up. You can always check our webpage for upcoming events and more information. Today, though, we are very pleased and very interested to introduce you to the John W. Brown. It is one of two Liberty ships still afloat. And if you say, what in the world is a Liberty ship? You're going to find out today with our presentation and some special videos. It's not saying too much to say the Liberty ship was a key ingredient in Allied victory in World War II. Our host at the John W. Brown is Liam Bauman, who joins us now. He's the chief mate of the SS John W. Brown. He's been involved with Project Liberty Ship for over 30 years, at least he says. He looks 25 to me, so I'll have to take his word for that. But he is actually the third generation of his family to have sailed on Liberty ships. And he also sails as a professional mariner with a commercial industrial service. And we certainly appreciate you joining us today, Liam.
Thank you very much. It's great to be here.
I understand it's been a tough year for the John W. Brown with COVID and for so many nonprofits and museums out there. So give us, before you start, give us a little status update. You haven't had to do any cruises lately, I understand.
Yeah, no, we're working on trying to find a way to start doing cruises and underway events again. The Brown is a lot like a lot of other museums and organizations like it, where the COVID's really hit us hard. We have to follow local guidelines. These ships, for many of people who haven't been on board, were built before the days of OSHA. So, they're not designed for modern, COVID protocols and things like that. So it's been a real challenge for us. We've definitely risen to the occasion, and we're starting to find ways to open the ship back up and do tours and bring people back on board now, and as well as doing a lot of training events and, basically ways to keep her afloat and continue on until things open back up.
Excellent. Well, that's one reason we wanted to feature the John W. Brown in one of our lunchbox lectures, just to raise some awareness and to let you know things are getting back to normal slowly but surely. After this program, I'm sure a lot of people want to venture up to Baltimore. We're going to see some videos about the ship, as I understand it, and knock on wood that the technology holds up. But do you want to introduce the videos?
I don't know which one you're going to be playing first, but one of them is called This Beautiful Ship. It's just a really, I actually haven't seen it yet, but I've been told it's a great kind of a picture show and an audio thing to showcase a lot of images from the vessel. And then the other one's going to be a video that one of our captains, Elena Bassiano, did. And it's great video, so hope everybody enjoys it.
Great. Well, I'll turn it over to Sarah then to get those started. And then we'll be back with Liam for some Q&A after a bit.
Baltimore, Maryland is home to an impressive group of historic vessels, ranging in size, type, and purpose. On this diamond anniversary of the end of World War II, it is important to note that more than half of those vessels played a role in America's success during the war. One in particular, Liberty Ship SS John W. Brown, sits at Pier 13, just around the corner from Fort McHenry. Thousands of Liberty ships were built as a solution to a major logistical problem during the war. These ugly ducklings, as they are often affectionately referred to, were crewed by U.S. merchant mariners and delivered much-needed munitions, equipment, cargo, and troops to Americans and allies overseas. Today, she is one of only two Liberty ships left operating from World War II. 78 years after her launch, Liberty ship SS John W. Brown continues to serve the community with the help of her all-volunteer crew. Hi, I'm Captain Elena Bassiano, and I've been a volunteer aboard SS John W. Brown since I was just 10 years old. After sailing aboard Liberty ships during the war, my grandfather introduced my older sister and me to the Brown, and the rest, as they say, is history. Not unlike many of our other younger volunteers, John W. Brown influenced and prepared me for a life at sea. Currently, both my sister and I are sailing as captains. Her as a Sandy Hook Harbor pilot in New York and New Jersey, and myself as a captain on an oceanographic survey vessel overseas. SS John W. Brown was launched September 7, 1942, Labor Day, right here in Baltimore. She was named, appropriately enough, after a labor leader from that era. Operated by a crew of merchant mariners and protected by a small contingency of naval armed guards, the Brown delivered supplies and later was refitted as a troop ship, carrying soldiers and POWs across the Atlantic for the remainder of the war. After the war, SS John W. Brown was repurposed as a maritime vocational high school in New York City, and in 1988 was brought back home to Baltimore by the volunteers of Project Liberty Ship. For the past 32 years, Project Liberty Ship has kept SS John W. Brown alive and steaming. Over 2 million volunteer service hours have contributed to keeping her lights on and the propeller turning. In addition to restoration, volunteers contribute to the underway operations of the Brown during our annual Living History cruises.
Straighten up and fly right. Cool
shipyard repair periods, and out-of-state port visits. Also, the crew provides pertinent information to the thousands of visitors that come aboard when the vessel is open to the public each year. The Brown has hosted tours for visitors from places as far-reaching as London and even Australia. One of the more impactful contributions John W. Brown makes to the community is by hosting many educational programs on board. SS John W. Brown volunteers provide a working platform of classes for local maritime union schools, security exercises for local law enforcement, hands-on training for Boy Scout troops, the Corps of Sea Cadets, and local high school STEM students, as well as in-house training to ensure crew proficiency. More recent and very popular programs hosted by Project Liberty Ship are the STEAM School and Deck Seaman Experience, where visitors get to stay aboard for a long weekend, attend educational lectures by passionate volunteers, receive hands-on training, and are eventually permitted to operate various ships' equipment. Have you ever lit off a boiler on a 78-year-old steamship? Project Liberty Ship SS John W. Brown is so much more than just a piece of America's great history. Current merchant mariners, such as myself, can earn underway days, and engineers can put time on their steam licenses, ensuring proficiency in operation of today's Ready Reserve fleet, in case American merchant mariners are, once again, required to answer the call in times of modern conflict. SS John W. Brown was born on Baltimore's great waterfront. She continues to operate today with the help of state and federal grants, profits from educational and social events, and most importantly, because of generous donations made from people just like you. As we navigate through these uncertain times, your contributions to Project Liberty Ship matter more than ever. Once you step aboard SS John W. Brown, the passion and care taken to keep her afloat becomes obvious. If you find yourself near the Port of Baltimore, stop by and see for yourself, or visit www.ssjohnwbrown.org for more information. Thank you. Heave ho, and let's keep her steaming.
Thank you. I also ask this Congress for authority and for funds sufficient to manufacture additional munitions and war supplies of many kinds to be turned over to those nations which are now in actual war with aggressor nations. Our most useful and immediate role is to act as an arsenal for them as well as for ourselves.
President Roosevelt called Liberty ships dreadful-looking objects. Time magazine called them ugly ducklings. But these prefabricated vessels could be built quickly. So early in 1941, only a few months after delivering his State of the Union address to Congress, the president ordered American shipyards to go into production. On September 27, 1941, the SS Patrick Henry was launched at the Baltimore Bethlehem Shipyard, the first of the 2,710 Liberty ships launched in 18 United States shipyards. The Baltimore shipyard built 384 Liberties, more than any other yard. Measuring almost 1.5 football fields in length, Liberty ships carried American tanks, trucks, airplanes, and troops to the fighting fronts in Europe and Asia. They became a bridge of ships during World War II. Their crews were civilians in the American Merchant Marine. Their defensive gunners were sailors in the Navy Armed Guard. 229 Liberties were lost, but those that survived helped win the war. One of them, the SS John W. Brown, was built in less than 2 months and launched from the Baltimore, Maryland shipyard on September 7, 1942. In her maiden voyage during the war, she sailed around Cape Horn and the Cape of Good Hope to the Soviet Union and then made 7 other voyages across the Atlantic to Europe and the Mediterranean. After the war, the Brown served for almost 40 years as a New York City school ship in New York Harbor, moored first in the East River and then in the Hudson. She was retired to the James River, Virginia Ghost Fleet in 1983, where she rusted for 5 years. In 1988, she was rescued and, unable to sail under her own power, she was towed to Baltimore. 3 years later, in 1991, she was ready to sail again. Since then, the Brown has made 80 living history cruises from ports up and down the Atlantic seaboard and in Canada. She has given thousands of visitors in ports or at sea a chance to learn about her role and the sacrifices made in winning the war. Living history cruises on the Brown take visitors on day-long sailing adventures from Baltimore into the Chesapeake Bay, recreating the wartime atmosphere experienced by those who once served in the mission. Over the past 20 years, hundreds of volunteers, many who served in World War II, have worked hard to make the Brown seaworthy, to become a living memorial to those valiant years in the history of America. Tireless efforts continue today in the endless tasks of removing rust and replacing parts to maintain her original beauty and to take her back into the open sea. The images and descriptions that follow capture the many details and moods of the Brown, of its simplicity and complexity, of the precision of its many fittings played against the rough edges of casual clutter. Perhaps most important of all in judging this measure of the ship's beauty are her shipmates. Originally strangers to each other, they have become family. Still, the question remains, were these ships dreadful-looking objects? Some may still say so. Those who built them and those who sailed them were proud of them. And alumni of other Liberty ships and those who saved the Brown are especially fond of this old steamer. Beyond its rugged utility in war and its value as an historical maritime treasure today, the Brown is truly a beautiful ship. On rough waters or still, she is a poem at sea. On this morning, the Brown's rudder at the stern captures sunbeams at the ship's berth on Clinton Street in East Baltimore. Across the water from the Brown, a freighter dispenses salt from Chile. The early sunshine creeps over the salt piles and lines up with the Brown's bulkhead, bringing a golden glow to the ship's hull of gray steel and reflections of the harbor on her bow. It's time to go to work. An engineer steps aboard as the dawn brightens the ship's deck. While the engineer tests her engine, the Brown's propeller forms rings in the harbor's still waters. One of two anchors that hang ready at her bow for use at sea is noticed by curious observers whose craft is dwarfed by the Brown. These numbers show the ship is riding high, only 10 feet or below the water's surface. She rode much deeper when loaded with almost 10,000 tons of tanks and trucks. And these simple load diagrams painted on the port side mark the safe limits for her cargo weight. Ice and snow cover the ship in winter while she is resting at her mooring. But below deck, volunteers are hard at work preparing the ship for another spring. This is one of the many lines used to make fast the ship when it's ashore. At sea, the line rides against the side above the waves made by the Brown. On deck, these lines are wound around iron heads called bitts to hold the ship in place. These empty line reels, called gypsy heads, are mounted alongside wooden hatches that cover the ship's holds. Once all the cargo is lowered into the holds, hatches are secured by metal strongbacks and wooden battens to batten the hatches. These broken and rusty rivets, taken from the restored Brown, are displayed with a heavy knot called a monkey's fist, which is used to help throw lines ashore. Here's a sample from a degaussing cable that encircled the ship in wartime. It was used to neutralize the ship's magnetic field and help avoid detection by U-boats. The yellow net suspended below the Brown's accommodation ladder provides additional safety if someone falls while going up or down. A spare anchor stored on the Brown's deck was salvaged from another Liberty ship that was resting in the James River. Life rings are positioned throughout the ship alongside cylindrical devices used to send distress signals if the ship encounters trouble at sea. Life jackets stored in racks are brought out for crew members to wear in regular fire and boat drills before each voyage. Inflatable life rafts secured in large metal canisters are checked periodically to keep them in good condition. And man ropes hang ready above the lifeboats when needed by crew members to shimmy down to a waiting boat. The superstructure rising above the main deck is the strategic control center for the ship. Having a commanding view of the sea, the closed bridge and the open flying bridge are flanked by lifeboats and gun tubs. Within the closed bridge is the wheelhouse, with three small windows facing forward and equipment needed by the captain to guide the Brown at sea. This gun sight on one of 12 guns is a reminder of the constant danger awaiting each Liberty as it transported reinforcements to the American troops far from home. The Brown's radio room has been refurbished in authentic World War II format by several volunteers who served as wartime radio operators. And this is the chart room where the ship's navigator lays out its course. One device monitors any deviations by the helmsman once the ship is underway. The bunks for troops below deck are stacked high, designed more for efficiency than for comfort, while the crew sleeps in rooms above called forecastles. A ship's steep ladder leads down into the engine room, the hard-working heart of the Brown, dominated by the abundant presence of oil, steam, dirt, and sweat. Many wheels and dials are needed to help put the ship in motion, including these instruments mounted on the fire room gauge board. These six important gauges monitor steam pressure. The larger red wheel controls the reversing gear. The smaller red wheel is the throttle that adjusts the ship's speed. Dominating the array of dials, levers, and controls is the critical engine order telegraph just to the left of a voice tube. It is used for direct communication with the bridge above. This important device allows officers on the bridge to maintain control of the ship's speed and direction. The Brown's two large boilers provide the steam power that turns the ship's original 18-foot diameter propeller. A complex array of pipes and valves carries and regulates the passage of steam from the boilers to the many components that bring the ship into motion. Three powerful cylinders in the Brown's original 2,500 horsepower triple expansion steam engine drive mechanical linkages that turn the drive shaft and propeller at 76 revolutions per minute. Massive gears below deck and on deck move into action, powered only by steam energy. When all preparations are in place to set sail, the fireman lights the boiler by putting fire in the hole. This action, also known by shipmates as lighting off, marks the beginning of the Brown's next adventure. In the summer of 2008, before going once again to sea, the Brown made a weekend visit to the Baltimore Inner Harbor. Resting quietly and looming large alongside the harbor pavilions, she was visited by thousands during the brief stay. Now fully restored to her original beauty, the Brown periodically goes into dry dock for repairs and a fresh coat of paint before returning to sea.
Thank you.
When the Brown is at sea, the restless and relentless movements of the ocean waters bring back the memories of war, of danger from enemies lurking below, of bonding with shipmates, of risking lives for freedom, of coming home. These boxes carry the ashes of deceased shipmates who have chosen to be buried at sea. On this voyage, a chaplain conducts a somber memorial ceremony, and a deceased shipmate is brought home to rest in the ocean depths. And on another occasion, a young couple is joined in marriage, the beginning of a new day and a new life together. The eerie silence of the sea, the play of light on shifting waters, and the ever-changing cloud formations are mesmerizing. When at sea, whether watching for a mounting storm or the setting sun, a seaman experiences moments of solitude and contemplation. One day in 1988, a group of World War II veterans and active mariners traveled to the National Defense Reserve Fleet off Fort Eustis, Virginia, to rescue the Rusty Brown from its graveyard in the James River. For more than 40 years, the Brown's engines had not powered the ship at sea, but after 3 years of hard work, these volunteers brought her back to life and took her for a shakedown cruise on the Chesapeake Bay. In 1999, this group of volunteers returned to the ghost fleet of derelict ships in Virginia to scavenge spare parts for the Brown from another abandoned Liberty ship, the Arthur M. Hedell. Undaunted by Hedell's badly rusted exterior, a day's work that began with expectant smiles and ended in exhaustion was rewarded by the retrieval of numerous well-preserved fixtures and fittings to add in the restoration of the Brown. This was one of more than 30 such expeditions by Brown volunteers working as pirates with permission to salvage parts from ships in the James River Ghost Fleet. Over the past 20 years, hundreds of volunteers have contributed more than 1.5 million hours maintaining and sailing the Brown. The photos that follow reveal the character, commitment, and camaraderie of the shipmates. I'm going to go to the hospital.
Since 1991, the Brown has offered sailing trips that recreate the days of World War II, taking young and old on patriotic trips into the Chesapeake Bay. These day-long adventures, accommodating up to 720 people, have become the main source of income to help sustain the activities of Project Liberty Ship. Here, the Brown prepares for another cruise as the Pride of Baltimore sails toward the Chesapeake Bay. A Jeep is loaded onto the deck of the Brown, one of many preparations before departure on these living history cruises, a reminder of the Liberty's mission during the war. Boarding passengers are greeted by the ship's crew at the beginning of a six-hour step back in time. Once aboard, visitors are encouraged to explore the ship in self-guided tours. Decorated veterans join with other visitors on a day's journey back to 1942. Museums dedicated to the Merchant Marine, the U.S. Navy Armed Guard, and World War II shipbuilders are found in several locations on the ship. Displayed are relics, posters, letters, and other memorabilia familiar to veterans but new to young visitors learning about the commitment and heroics of one generation of Americans to preserve our freedom. A rare prize on display is the wheel that steered the Patrick Henry, the first Liberty ship. Along the way, passengers chat with members of the crew and other veterans sharing stories of the war. The sound of a band playing wartime songs mingles with a murmur of relaxing conversations and a landscape of smiling faces. As the Brown continues toward the bay, veterans pause to salute the flag at Fort McHenry, home of the Star-Spangled Banner, where another generation once fought for freedom. On this day, as the Chesapeake Bay comes into view, emerging slowly through the morning mist, the Brown joins with a large fleet of weekend sailors. Passengers learn that many of these sailors are competing in an international around-the-world race, an extra benefit of choosing this day to enjoy the Brown's living history cruise. Continuing her adventure, the Brown glides further into the bay, just as she did when she was first launched on her maiden voyage from the Baltimore shipyard almost 70 years ago. Music is always a key part of a cruise. Here, a Maryland high school choir entertains the passengers with patriotic songs that buoyed the spirits of sailors and soldiers during the war. These four women, decked out in high fashion from the 40s, belt out favorite tunes that bring back memories for those who worked and waited on the home front. A crew member invites a visitor to join in the fun. They dance with youthful energy. Professional actors play President Roosevelt and General MacArthur, leaders on the home front and the battlefield. Also on board is an actor who plays the role of General Patton. The tradition of placing a wreath on the water provides an emotional highlight on each cruise, remembering those who died at sea in the war. Often, groups of veterans are reunited on the Brown. Assembled on this day was a group of graduates of the U.S. Merchant Marine Academy at Kings Point, New York. As the sound of military band music sweeps over the deck, sailors in full uniform stand at attention, present arms, and remind visitors of their roles in protecting the liberties from enemy attack. As the Brown makes its way further into the bay, the sound of warplanes approaching draws the attention of passengers to the sky. One crosses over the ship as it patrols the sea on alert for enemy boats. Colorful signal flags flutter high up on the mast as the Brown moves steadily forward. In wartime, her destination was to unseen shores, sometimes unknown shores, but always with the flag of freedom as her guide.
People of Western Europe, a landing was made this morning on the coast of France by troops of the Allied Expeditionary Force. This landing is part of the concerted United Nations plan for the liberation of Europe, made in conjunction with our great Russian allies. Thank you.
bed with my woman just singing the blues, heard the radio telling the news. Said the big red army took 100 towns and allies, dropping them 2-ton bombs. Started hollering, yelling, dancing up and down like a bullfrog. Doorbell rung and in come a man, signed my name, I got a telegram. Said, if you want to take a vacation trip, got a dishwashing job on a Liberty ship. Woman a-crying, me a-flying, out the door and down the line. About 2 minutes, I run 10 blocks, I come to my ship, down at the dock. Walked up the plank and I signed my name, blowed that whistle and was gone again. Right on out and down the stream. Ships dispersed, my eye could see. Woman awake. Ship loaded down with TNT, all out across the rolling sea. Stood on the deck, watched the fishes swim. I was praying them fish wasn't made out of tin. Walked to the tail, stood on the stern, looking at the big brass screw blade turn. Listened to the sound of the engine pound. Gained 16 feet every time went around. Getting closer and closer. Look out, you fascists. I'm just one of the merchant crew. I belong to the union called the NMU. I'm a union man from head to toe. I'm USA and CIO. Fighting out here on the waters to win some freedom on the land.
Let's say goodbye with a smile, dear, just for a while, dear. We must part. Don't let this parting upset you. I'll not forget you, sweetheart. We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again. Some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies chase those dark clouds far away. And I will just say hello to the folks that you know, tell them you won't be long. They'll be happy to know that as I saw you go, you were singing this song. We'll meet again, don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.
Okay, we are back. That was great, Liam. I especially love the music.
Yeah, I don't know how I follow that presentation.
That's a great reminder. we have to commend you and your crew for the work you're doing in preserving that very vital and underappreciated history. I was also reminded that May 22nd coming up is National Maritime Day. And any active or veteran merchant marine is welcome to a complimentary mission to the National D-Day Memorial. So invite you to come by or send by any other merchant mariners you know. We'd love to have you because while, of course, you know, we're here to tell the story of D-Day, we never miss an opportunity to remind people what the merchant marine did to win World War II and what it cost them, just the number of losses as well. So great. Ready to take some questions?
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. Let me go down the list here. While we're scrolling down to look at the questions, a lot of greetings and thank yous for the program. But I guess you don't get veterans, World War II veterans, visiting as often as you used to. Do you remember the last time an actual veteran of the Brown paid a visit to the ship?
Yeah, actually, that's a really good question. So we had, for many years, we were doing the cruises and we had World War II veterans coming down all the time. And that generation is very quickly fading away. They're not as mobile anymore. Can't get down to the ship as often. So we don't see it as much anymore, especially in the last year or so. And we do have several crew members that are World War II veterans that still come down. They try to, they do volunteer whenever they can. So that's a really big part of it. And I've been very lucky to have met as many as I have, because one of the coolest things you ever get to do is sit there and just listen to these stories that they want to tell. And they want to tell you about all the cool stuff. You never ask them about the bad things. It's a really, truly unique experience.
Much the same here at the memorial. We because of COVID, we have not seen World War II veterans the past year as much as we would have loved to have. But when they're here, boys, just to sit down and listen to their memories is a treat. And we appreciate that. Another question has come in. Have any modern electronics or navigation technology been added to the ship?
Yes. So we have done some modifications just to keep up with the times because, the ship is still operating on active waterways. So we do have gyro compasses. We have, radars and AIS, GPS, all of that stuff. But for the most part, we've tried to keep it true to the, what the ship was back in World War II. So I've seen a lot of people come on board, especially younger mariners, and one of my favorite ones was somebody walked into the wheelhouse and says, "Well, where's your ECDIS, which is an electronic chart display system?" And we looked at her and, "What's an ECDIS?" And so that's, a lot of people nowadays are using, they're so dependent on this technology that coming onto the Brown, you get to do things the old fashioned way. You actually get to go up and work through the math, and you don't just get a piece of equipment just giving you all the answers. We've done a lot of modernization on the ship. We also have sound systems, PA systems, all of the things that you'd expect on a modern vessel.
Excellent. What would you say is your biggest maintenance challenge?
I don't know where to begin on that one. it's a constant battle. It's like any other ship. It's the second you finish everything, you go and you start back over again. We have a great team of engineers working down below, maintaining the engine room, and they do a great job. Out on deck is the same thing. We've got a great group of volunteers. We've got people that are maintaining and upgrading our radio systems, and it's pretty much the whole ship is, it's a constant project. It's kind of hard to answer that question.
I would imagine so, but again, yeah. It's amazing to see what you've done, just to preserve the history and pass it on forward is absolutely essential. What we do here at the National D-Day Memorial on a different subject, but we are always eager to partner with other organizations that are doing the same thing. So we appreciate you being with us today and sharing your experiences and your videos with us. We're about out of time, but want to thank everyone who has joined in for watching, and encourage you to come by Bedford and see us here at the National D-Day Memorial, and then head up to Baltimore and check out the John W. Brown. And I look forward to when you're back at sea with cruises.
Yeah, and if anybody wants to check us out, it's ssjohnwbrown.org. And we're also on social media, so if you want to look us up, and hopefully soon we'll be starting to do appointment-only tours and eventually open up 100%. So thanks again for having me. Really appreciate it.
Thank you, and happy sailing.
Thank you.